ter 20 e poucos anos e ser muito, muito rico mesmo, de nascença. Depois, além de ter esse dinheiro todo, entrar para uma banda de rock, se transformando em ídolo de milhares de jovens modernos no mundo todo. Maravilha, né? Pois essa história existe de verdade. É a história da banda nova-iorquina The Strokes, cinco rapazes muito bem nascidos de Manhattan, que agora, ainda por cima, se transformaram em astros do rock. O Almanac foi até San Diego, na Califórnia, para falar com os Strokes, que são herdeiros legítimos da tradição roqueira de Nova York. Vamos ver o que esses meninos têm a dizer?
Who comes up with the songs? And you told me that Julian always starts it, and then everybody sort of
he writes and arranges and stuff, and we go into the studio.
Helps with dance.
He dances and
I tap dance.
The lyrics, for example, 100%, you write them all.
Yeah.
And the tunes.
Pretty much, yeah.
And then what? You write them, and what does the rest of the band do before they actually record it or play it live?
I don't know. We play it all together, and then when we all agree what we like, then that becomes a song.
So that's sort of a democracy. Has it ever happened that you came up with something that they didn't like?
Yeah, sure.
And then what do you do?
We don't play it.
you could rewrite it.
Well, we work on it. Basically, we just keep doing stuff, and then when we all like it, then we go from there. To something that someone doesn't like, then that hasn't really happened in a while, but I don't know, it depends on the situation. There's, been about a million different situations with different parts, so it's hard to generalize,
What's an ideal situation for you after you come up with something? Ideally, what would happen?
Ideally?
Yeah, it would be perfectly.
They wouldn't say a word and...
Go into the studio and the song is magically there.
Oh, that was great, guys. Go home.
Yeah, he brainwashes us to think that everything that he does is magical.
O baterista Fabrício Moretti tem laços estreitos com o Brasil. Ele nasceu no Rio de Janeiro e, apesar da vergonha, ainda fala um bom português.
Você faz ideia que um dia os Strokes iam fazer sucesso no Brasil?
Pra dizer a verdade, não, mas eu tô muito feliz que aconteceu.
Explica pro pessoal do Brasil qual é a tua relação com o Brasil. Onde você nasceu, quando que você foi embora?
A minha mãe é brasileira e eu nasci no Rio. E... I think... Quando eu tinha 4 anos, alguma coisa assim, I moved to New York. Eu fui para Nova York com meu pai e a minha mãe também.
You
don't understand what I'm saying.
But you still have family in Brazil?
Claro. Loved family.
Mm-hmm. Cousins.
Cousins. Eu tenho a girl cousin chamada Fernanda, mm-hmm. e o Gabriel e a minha tia Diná.
E eles moram todos no Rio?
E a minha avó também. Angela.
Moram todos no Rio?
Todos no Rio.
E por que que você ainda fala português? Com quem que você fala português?
Com ninguém, por isso que... I'm so bad at this.
Além de ídolo do rock independente, Fabrício frequenta as revistas americanas de fofocas. Foi fotografado recentemente aos beijos com a atriz Drew Barrymore, uma deusa de Hollywood. Será que as mulheres assediam muito os Strokes?
What a funny question to ask. I guess,
it's... likes to fuck.
I like girls just as much as the next man, but... I don't know, I guess things come with a certain territory, you know what I mean? And, if someone sees you on stage playing rock and roll, I guess they're more in tune with, being open with you because you were just open with them. Mm-hmm. So I guess those offers come.
Do you think you ever get tired of it?
I don't think so, man. I don't think so. I was actually talking to a friend of mine in his car, and he said, he's sort of done this for a while. He's like, dude, at the point you're gonna have to settle down and get married. It's like, but you don't worry about that right now. And I was like, okay, because I can't picture that.
Is rock and roll life less crazy or more crazy than you thought it would be before you joined a band?
Less crazy, definitely.
And is that good or bad?
Good. It's comfortable. It's, not normal, but not,
too out of, normal.
It's not out of hand, I don't think it's really, I imagine what people think our lives are like is a much more exaggerated version of what it is. It's not like that. I doubt that even those stories of what went on then in the 80s are true, really.
Yeah. Well,
it's like, it's blown out of proportion, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, we lead pretty normal lives.
And we also had good, like, parents who taught us well, you know? And so, like, we always have values that we stick to. And we never let each other get out of hand, because whenever we start thinking that we have the power as friends to sort of sit together and work out our differences and stuff.
Thinking about dealing with fame, and he was saying that things are actually much less crazy than he thought they would be.
Yeah.
And Fabrice is saying that you guys...
Well, we keep each other in check, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, we try to keep each other normal, you know what I mean? But, it's less crazy, I think. I think there's also, we try to, you know, calm it down a little bit, not get too wrapped up and do, like, you know, like, this is the first interview we've done in, like, a long time, you know? Just, like, we usually try not to bother with that kind of stuff, because that's just, like, playing the fame game, and that's not really what we're into.
Julian está acostumado desde criança a uma vida de glamour. Ele é filho de John Casablancas, um dos maiores magnatas do mundo da moda.
I was reading this interview with John Holmstrom from Punk magazine from back in the 70s, and he was saying that there is a love-hate relationship between New York and you guys, because maybe indie New York, sort of a middle class or blue collar kind of thing, and you guys are have a too wealthy background to actually be New York indie. Is that something that really bothers you, or that you notice?
No, not really. I mean, I think that's sort of bullshit too, because when we started, you know, we were like sort of considered indie, you know, like no one knew us, and we were playing small shows. Then we were cool, but as soon as you get popular, you know, like it's always like the hipsters always want to like knock you down. So I don't give a shit.
People turn on you, just like Spider-Man said.
But did you actually notice? Did you guys get some kind of flack in New York for being too famous?
Nicola?
Not really. I don't really pay attention.
Mm-hmm.
So if people want to think a certain way, I think it's fine with us, you know.
Mm-hmm. Personally, I'd like to walk down the street with my fur coat and my glasses, big glasses, and my jewelry and stuff like that.
Lenny Kravitz kind of look.
Just kidding.
I was reading, I'm not sure where I was reading that, you guys might be the kind of band that would be concerned about what kind of people are listening to your music. You know, like uncool people don't even get close.
Yeah,
does that make any sense?
I think everyone should listen to the music. If it's really good, everyone can like it, you know what I mean?
Music is for people, you know? It's not, you know, who am I to judge who should listen to this?
Actually,
something,
you know what's funny? Because in Brazil, like, I had no idea that it would go so well in Brazil, and from what my family tells me, it's been going pretty well, and I just, it's very nice to know that where I'm from is, like, sort of liking the music that we make, you know what I mean?
Julian, you were saying this is bullshit. I mean, you would like to be heard by as many people as possible, right?
Yeah, but probably uncool people more than cool people, you know? That's not totally not what it's about. I mean, you listen to the music, it's, you know, sort of the opposite of that, you know?
What's it like when you're on the road and you're listening to something and it comes then, say, it comes a Creed song and then a Nickelback song and then the Strokes?
I think
pretty cool.
I think we raise the volume really quick on the radio and just start, like, giggling to ourselves. Not really.
A year ago, would you envision that you would be big on U.S. radio? A year ago?
I don't know. It was a dream, you know? I couldn't really picture it. I had a lot of trouble picturing it.
Mm-hmm.
But now that it's happening, I don't know. I mean, we're just sort of starting, so I can't really tell. I can't really judge, like,
mm-hmm.
you know, I can't really judge where we stand yet because we're still sort of starting, you know? We only have one single out in America.
True.
It's just hard to explain. We just, you know, just did sort of like a video. We're trying to finish the video and
it's not finished yet. Hard to explain.
Sort of finished. I don't know. It's not out yet, but I mean, we have it. You know, so one song. It's like last night. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't really gauge so well. You know, how I feel like we fit in the mainstream. You know.
I was living in San Francisco until last December, and I remember you guys playing with the Doves, and then the Bottom of the Hill, and then the Fillmore, and that was San Francisco only. Of course, you've been playing pretty much all over the world. So you guys been on tour for how long now?
3 months.
No.
About we stopped the tour at the beginning of April, took about 10 days off, and then came out to.
How did that go?
The tour?
Yeah. Starting with the Doves.
Starting with the Doves. Wow, going backwards. It was great. That was the first time we ever toured America. You know, first time we got to play outside of New York, really, and playing like good venues with a good band, with people there. You know, it wasn't like empty. There was lots of people, so it was a good opportunity for us.
Is this a tour right now or a one-off event?
No, this is like a one-off event, I guess. Yeah.
And after this, what you gonna do?
I'm gonna go back to New York and do some other shows, I think, in May.
Basically, what you've described is touring. You're not gonna do a new, record new songs or anything like that. You have that in plan for you?
Julian.
You're the writer.
I'm the leprechaun.
I don't know. We're just gonna tour this album for like as long as we can, like 5 years. No, we have some new songs. Yeah, as soon as we're done and we have enough new songs, hopefully by September we start recording something.
When I saw the gig, I think the gig at the bottom of the hill, you played the 11 songs in order. Did you still do that?
No. That was, no. Not really, no.
Was that an accident or did that on purpose?
No, that was a long time. That was before our album came out, I think.
Mm-hmm. Before we recorded it.
Yeah, now we got new songs, so like the configuration has to change a little bit, you know?
I think it was just for that tour, you know? We were really excited about the set list. It had gone well. It had gone over well.
Actually, we used to play the same set list, and we liked it so much so that we used the album order. We used the album order on the set list order on the record.
Yeah.
All right, it was the other way around.
Na ficha técnica do CD é uma novidade, invenção dos Strokes. Eles dão crédito a J.P. Bowersock, chamado de guru da banda. Quem será essa figura?
What's the deal with the guru, J.P.? Exactly, what is his influence?
He was Albert's guitar teacher, and then became my guitar teacher too. So we still take lessons with him, and he knows a lot about music. So when we were making the record, sometimes he'd come in, and I don't know. He just gave us a lot of good advice, you know. Taught us a lot about, you know, music.
Advice in what music? Musical advice.
Mm-hmm. It also helped him buy that, you know, and kind of a lot of times when you're in the studio, you don't know whether that was a take or you should do it again.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really nice to have a guy you trust and says, that's the one, and you're like, okay, you're right.
Even at shows, though, too, like, after a show would happen, he'd always be there, whether it's like the smallest gig or the bigger ones, he'd always be there to like sort of give positive criticism and help us out, even like drum lines.
Even the
stuff.
Beginning, even like the before, like, I mean, like when 10 people were there, he was there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because what you just described, I mean, someone saying this is a take, this is not. I mean, the producer does that too, right? Could do it normally.
Sure.
I mean, not all bands have a guru. That's what I mean.
No, of course.
Why is he so important?
We don't have the guru thing. It's sort of a joke. You know what I mean? He's not really like a guru. You know?
He doesn't float.
Like, we don't want to sit and meditate with him. Right?
We were just thinking. It was sort of like a last minute thing when we were done with the record. Like, what should we write on the, you know?
But like, would you go to the studio and record without him?
No. I mean, I think we'd always invite him over. You know, because we're still friends.
I think we tried doing that once, and it was like, oh man, you could really feel his absence.
Is this really good?
No. Like. You know, you could feel the fact that he was missing, and Julian called him up and was like, come on, man, we need you.
Actually, he just adds a good vibe to the studio, you know? Mm-hmm. Just, he adds, and I think anything that adds to a record that you don't even know how it's going to come out or you're all nervous about it is good. It's a good thing, you know?
Mm-hmm. What band are you here to see?
Strokes.
All right. Why do you think they're good?
I just love the music. It's raw. It doesn't seem so like produced. That's what I love the music about.
How about yourself?
Strokes.
Why do you like them?
They sound like really raunchy and just raw, the garage band, you know? As soon as I heard it, I was on it. It's one of those CDs that you could buy and you could listen to all the way through. Now, like, when you skip a fucking song, you just like listen to it all the way through, all the way home.
What band are you here for? Oh, we're here for the Strokes, man. So, why do you think the Strokes are cool?
Bringing back the sound of the 70s.
Mm-hmm.
That's great stuff.
But you were not alive then.
Yeah, I know, but it's, well, I mean, nobody makes music like that nowadays, you know? It's all just
generated pop bullshit, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I like it. It's different.
I like them. I think I like their music a lot. I just like the music. I think it's good. It's good to dance to.
I saw you guys getting together back there when you arrived and hugging and hanging out with the fans. And I mean, being as big as you are right now, you seem really down to earth to me. How does that work for you? That's how you make a point in being down to earth, or you think at one certain point you're just gonna lose it and let rock and roll rule?
No, I just think, I don't know, I think we always try to be as natural as we can be, you know. I mean, we just try, you know, try to do the right thing. I don't know, I'm just, people come to the show, I appreciate it. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of, you know, first reason why you start playing. I mean, not maybe not why you start, but, you know, when you're doing it, you're trying to make people feel good, so,
Nikolai's already lost it, though, to the rock and roll.
You already did, Nikolai. Yeah, rock and roll, rules your life. Yeah. How does that go?
Just kidding. Yeah, my life is pretty crazy. Got a Corvette, you know, nice house.
I think it was good to fans, Elvis.
All right.
Elvis was good to everyone, man. I heard he
except
liked
himself.
Except his wife and himself. But like I heard he had a maid. He like wanted grits at like 3 o'clock in the morning or something like that. And he sent his maid in his Rolls Royce. And when she came back and found him grits, he was so happy he gave her the car that she took to drive. To
leave cars
grits.
To everyone, that guy. Man.
That guy.
I like your face. Have a car.
I heard he like knocked on Nixon's door, like nobody was expecting him to come. He's like, hey, could I be like an agent or something?
Yeah, that was a weird story.
And Nixon was like, sure, I love you, man.
All the way till the summer, pretty much. Uh-huh. Like little business trips, almost like 3 shows back home, 3 weeks.
Do you ride on the road, Julian?
Not really. No, it's really hard on the road.
So how did the new songs come up?
Like 30 seconds that we're back in New York. Just like, you know, stay in all day and work on music. And that's sort of the time frame when they got written, yeah.
You write with them or you write alone and then?
Alone.
So it never happens on tour on the bus or anything.
I mean, some stuff of the new song actually was written on the road, but it doesn't really take any kind of shape until we get back to New York.
You guys already have how many new songs, you said?
Three new songs. And When It Started, which was replaced in the U.S. album by, it replaced New York City Cops. So mm-hmm. In Brazil, I don't think they have When It Started yet, mm-hmm. You know.
The three new ones, you've already recorded that?
No, not yet. No, we're in the process of like the way that a song becomes final is by like playing it as many times as we possibly can live, so mm-hmm. that we know what's wrong and what's right with the song, and we can see the reactions of the people and stuff, and so we can all put it together, you know. So we haven't recorded it yet. We're just still in the testing part.
And you test it live, playing it live.
Yeah, pretty much.
Mm-hmm. All of you prefer touring to recording, or not?
No,
it doesn't matter.
It's like saying if you like steak or pizza.
You can like what?
You can like both just as much.
You're gonna do the European summer festivals this year?
No, I refuse.
Why is that? You did it last year, right?
We did a couple. I don't know, because we're not really gonna tour. We're just gonna do like little trips.
We're doing Reading.
Well, yeah.
You're doing Reading this year?
We're headlining it.
You headlined it last year, didn't you?
No, we just played it. Uh-huh. Yeah, Travis headlined it.
No, actually, we were supposed to play the small stage last year.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
And then moved to the big stage, but not headlining.
I mean, Reading is the biggest one of all. Does it make a difference for you guys to play to a very small audience in a small club or do something huge like Reading?
We didn't really want to play any summer festivals. We sort of wanted to take some time to work on new stuff. So we just decided to do one, you know? I think that's the one where most people come from, like, other places. So we thought we'd, you know, please as many people as we could, but then not really, like, cut in so we could, you know, please more people later.
But what's it like for you, the lead singer, to be playing in a huge place like Reading or in a smaller place like, I don't know, bottom of the hill? Does it make a difference for you?
scares you in a way?
Yeah, well, it's different, you know, it's like an intimate, like, it's like the difference between hanging out with some friends and, like, being at a huge party. I don't know, it's...
Nerve-wise.
Nerve-wise, it really depends, you know. I'd probably be pretty nervous before Reading.
Yeah, I don't think that it, like, the nervousness that you feel going out into a stage like this really compares to the nervousness that you feel going out into a festival. I, like, feel like my heart's going to explode out of my chest when I'm going to go out on a festival.
It's very different.
But,
Reading was probably like that last year.
Sorry, buddy. I think the truth is just because in a festival situation you've got to convince people that you're good. Here it's like more like your fans are here. You know, you feel like you're going to play to friends, like you said.
Segundo muitos críticos, os Strokes deram nova vida ao rock de Nova York, que andava caído, mas que tem longa tradição. Do niilismo urbano de Lou Reed... ao punk pioneiro dos Ramones. Do ruído branco do Sonic Youth. As experiências de David Byrne e os Talking Heads.
What do you see yourself doing 10 years from now? I know you're too young for that, but you guys have already had so much so soon. So not even the Beatles were that big when they were like 21 or 22. So what do you think you'll be doing 10 years from now?
Probably time traveling.
No, seriously.
No, playing music, of course.
In a band, doing your own solo experimental projects or what?
The Fab Moretti experience. I hope to be playing with these guys, and who knows.
Mm-hmm.
If all goes well, we should still be playing together. All might not go well, though.
Fim da entrevista. É hora do show para quase 5 mil pessoas dentro do campus da Universidade da Califórnia em San Diego. A diversão é total. Eles são jovens, ricos e famosos. O mundo do rock and roll é dos Strokes.